Tonight we're going to be asking Brother Creo to come. He's from Apostolic Tabernacle here in town, and he's a minister of the gospel. And I've asked him to come to talk about prison ministry and jail ministry, and to really see what the Lord wants to do at Lighthouse of the Valley in that endeavor. Can you say amen? So without anything else, Brother Creo, keep on talking. Good friend of mine. And also, he's a chaplain with the Stockton Police Department. He's also a full-time minister in the prison, so he does that full-time as a job. That's what he's hired by either the state or county or something, government. But anyway, he knows what he's talking about. He's been doing this for years, and he'll be able to share his testimony or share whatever he wants to share here tonight. And I told him to take his liberty and see what we can do. Can you say amen? Praise God. I like that. I like that. Amen, Brother Creel.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. Well, we thank the Lord for being here today with you, and it's a privilege and honor. My good friend, Pastor Delgado, amen. I met him in 2007 when I became a Stockton PD chaplain. He was one of the first ones I met, and we thank the Lord, amen, for our friendship since then. We thank the Lord for all he is doing. Amen. And I feel like I'm at home with apostolics. Hallelujah. One of my disclaimers is I went from an alcoholic to an apostolic. Hallelujah. I know how to get drunk, but it's in the Holy Ghost. And there is no high like the Most High. I don't know. I might be talking to too many church folks that don't know what I'm talking about, where God has brought you from. Amen. But we thank the Lord for all he is doing. Thank you so much. Last time I turned down a drink, I didn't hear the question. Amen. Well, God is good. Hallelujah. Amen. Let me just God has something special. God has something special in the days that we're living in. I'm going to share with you one of my passions, one of my desires of what being apostolic is and what God has called us. God has called us to be. You know, in nowadays, we don't know what I'm talking about, but some people might. But in the prisons, what they do is they have antennas, and they put foils sometimes on the wall. Then they'd put it to the ceiling. Then they'd go down to the door just so that they can have the right frequency to watch the television or to hear the radio. You and I have a frequency, and it's called reaching out to him. And it's our hands. I wonder if someone here can just join me right now. And let's get in tune with God. Let's get into his, what he has for us tonight. Father, as our hands are lifted to you, it is for your honor, your glory, your praise. We ask you to have your way tonight, Lord. I ask you, Lord, every person by the sound of my voice, God, that you continue to move in their lives, in their families, in their future, in the finances, Lord. I speak a double portion of faith to obtain everything that you have for them, Lord. We believe in your power. We believe in you right now in the name of Jesus. Clap your hands if you believe that with me. We can stand for the reading of the word, Exodus chapter 15, verse 26. And the Bible says, call on my help now. And said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and will give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, and I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee. For I am the Lord that healeth thee. You may be seated. There's power in prayer. God don't hear complaining. God doesn't hear murmuring. God doesn't hear gossiping. But one thing that God does hear, he hears someone who prays. He hears someone that can call on a living God. He hears you and I am a minister at Apostolic Tabernacle. My beautiful wife is here with me. Amen. Tonight, we thank the Lord for her. It's not every day that I get to minister with my wife here. A lot of times we minister in the prisons and amen. And she doesn't get to attend with me. Amen. I took her one time. And we were in there, and we had, I think that night we had 50 baptisms. We fed close to 100 men. We were there about probably 3-4 hours. I walked out, amen, feeling great. My wife looked at me and said, I don't want to come back. But ministry isn't for everybody. Ministry, amen, and we're going to get into this just in just a minute. As I heard the first song, God began to minister to me. But God began to show me, because, you know, one thing that the Father is looking for. You see, because everyone has breath. Everyone is breathing. But the Bible says what he's looking for is a worshiper. He's looking for someone who can worship him. I can praise him for a job. I can praise him for a house. Praise him for a car. Praise him for a raise. I can praise him for all the good things that he does in my life and my family. But I worship him simply for who he is. If I didn't have the car, if I didn't have the house, if I didn't have the job, if I didn't have the money, I just worship him for who he is. Someone shout hallelujah. Because when we started singing that song, God showed me one thing about hallelujah. The hallelujah, it ain't nobody but his. It's his praise. Warriors can score. Raiders can score. Well, sometimes, but amen. The Niners can score. And you might say hallelujah because of what you just seen, but it isn't going to the team. That hallelujah is for God and God Almighty. Now, I trip out on that song because it says you deserve it. Anyone know why he deserves it? Not because we're good, but he deserves it because he's good. Ain't nobody good save him that has something called the Holy Ghost living inside of them. Because if you didn't have the Holy Ghost, you wouldn't be good. But I want to minister for just a few minutes. Amen. I got to see, amen, Pastor, the other day, and I shared, amen, some of my testimony, and the Lord hasn't impressed on me to share it yet. Maybe I want to come back again, but I don't know. Hallelujah. But I shared with him, amen, a short testimony of how God dealt with my life. You see, I was born and raised in a pastor's home. I'm a fourth generation apostolic. I was born and raised in this thing, but from the age of 18 to 23, I was a prodigal son. Prodigal simply means wasted time. And as I was out doing my thing at the age of 18 to 23, I was probably about 19 or 20 years old. And I ended up getting a ticket. And I went to go see the judge, and I stood before the judge, and he gave me a fine, and I said, well, I can't pay the fine. I don't think that I couldn't pay it. I think I didn't want to pay it. Y'all get that later. So I said I couldn't pay it, so they said, okay, you can go do community service. Well, let me tell you something. You got to pay for community service too, so you don't get away with nothing. You still got to pay. So I paid for the community service, and they gave me 10 days. And when I did the 10 days, I did all of them, save one. The 10th day, I didn't make it. I went back to the judge, stood before the judge, thinking, you know, he was going to let me go. He was going to say, ah, it's just a day. 9 out of 10 ain't bad. That's pretty good. And the judge said, why didn't you do your 10th day? And I said, I just didn't have time before I had to come see you again. I said, I tried, but I didn't make it. They didn't let me in. I was late. He said, okay, this Friday you're going to turn yourself in at the Fresno County Jail. I said, what? They said, this Friday at 7 p.m., you're going to turn yourself in to the Fresno County Jail. So I went to work that day, and remember, got off work, and we started drinking and carrying on with our friends. And I'll never forget, we pulled up on the sidewalk there, downtown Fresno, and I got off the car, and I could hear, I'm keeping watch of the clock, amen, I could hear my friends laughing at me as they were driving away, thinking I was buzzing, thinking I was having a good time, but as soon as I touched the handle of that door, the buzz went away. Things just got real. I walked in. They weren't greeting me like my mom and dad greet me when I get home. They opened up a door. I walked in that door. And when I walked in that door, it was the booking cell. They took my picture. Then they took me all the ways to the other side of the building to the releasing cell. I was there at 7 p.m. They let me out at midnight. I was there 5 hours. I tell this story all the time. I work at Tracy. I'm a supervisor counselor at Tracy, dealing with men that are doing life, dealing with men. And one guy told me yesterday he has double life, which means after he does this life, if he ever comes back, he's going to do that life too. It's unthinkable. But to tell them, it took me 5 hours to realize this wasn't the life for me. It took me 5 hours to realize. And just in those 5 hours, you realize what life is about. I remember getting out. I got out that night at midnight, and when I walked out, friends weren't there. They kept carrying on. Too embarrassed to call dad. I ended up walking home. Remember my dad telling me, you got to watch out the friends you hang out with. You got to watch out who you're with. That didn't get me to come to the Lord. That didn't get me to give my life to Christ. That didn't, you know, that just kind of woke me up for just a little while. Then in 1993, I was at a nightclub there in Stockton. Excuse me, there in Fresno. It was called Beethoven's. It was 10 minutes till 2. And I was there at the nightclub. And some people call it a moment of clarity. I call it a moment with Jesus. Watch out when you have those Jesus moments. He will change your life. Paul had a Jesus moment on the way to Damascus. And when Jesus came into his life, he was never the same. You know what Paul declared himself? A prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not a prisoner of his past, not a prisoner of this world, not a prisoner of alcohol, not a prisoner of drugs, not a prisoner of bills or money, but he was a prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ because he gave his life to Christ. And I remember walking in or walking out of that bar, putting the beer down. It was 10 minutes till 2 and I walked out. And from 1993 to today, I've never walked in another bar since. We baptized a man end of last year. Amen. He's at our church. His name was Esteban. When we baptized Esteban, amen, he gives a testimony. He couldn't stop drinking. He couldn't stop smoking. But as soon as he got baptized in Jesus' name, all that went away. All the desires went away. He don't want to smoke no more. He don't want to drink no more. It is the power of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That night, I get out. And when I get out of the bar and I go home. The next day, I called up my sister and I said, "What are you doing today?" She said, and this was back in the 90s when sinspirations were like, you know, the end thing to do. But there was like a sinspiration. Those of you that don't know what those are concerts. Then they have a little preaching. Then they have more music. It's a concert. But I went with her, amen, to this sinspiration. And man, it'd been a long time since I've been to church. I got the Holy Ghost. In 1983, amen, at an apostolic altar, amen, in Kerman, California. And let me tell you something, when you have this Holy Ghost, it doesn't leave you. It doesn't ever leave you. I'm talking to a parent, a grandparent. If your children were filled with the Holy Ghost, it hasn't left them. It's still living inside of them. And I walked in to the service in Bakersfield and God refilled me, or I should say, amen, I accepted one more time the gift of the Holy Ghost. And when I got, amen, I remember driving. We drove Bakersfield to Fresno. It was 2 hours, about two and a half hours. And I remember just driving back to Fresno thinking, what are my friends going to say? What are my friends going to do? And, amen, there would be times, amen, because at my, amen, at my house, amen, we converted my garage into a pool room. I had a friend that owned a billiards hall, and he had a bunch of pool tables, and he built me a brand new, beautiful pool table in my garage. I had another friend who worked for Coors, and he brought me all these mirrors, and you know, and everyone would come over, and we would just play pool and drink beer. It wouldn't hurt nobody. Thought it was okay. But when you allow Jesus back in your life, there's no room for this world. There's no room for this world. And at my mom and dad's house. My mama still lives there today. Amen. But downstairs in the basement, there was these windows, and my buddies would look in the windows, and they would be tapping on the window saying, "We see you. We see your leg. We know you're in there." They wanted me to come back out. Come on, Ben, just one game. Let's just play pool one time. Never give the devil, never give the enemy the opportunity. He'll take it. He'll take it. And he'll keep you. We moved up to Stockton, me and my beautiful wife, amen, and got married in 95. We moved in 97. I went to Folsom Prison. Not Folsom Prison. That was the first men's prison I ever went to. But me and my wife went to the women's prison here in Stockton. Amen. A brother by the name of Dan Montano. I had got ordained on Saturday, and then on Sunday he said, "What are you doing?" And this was back in the day when you had Sunday school in the morning, then a night service. I remember those? Sunday school didn't go at night. Well, in between, there was a 12 to 2 o'clock service at the prison. And he's like, "How would you like to go to the prison?" "Okay, let's go." And I went with him and me and my wife. And first day me and my wife walked in there, I had the privilege of baptizing 17 women in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. That first year of ministry, me and my wife, amen, we went in. Almost every Saturday we would go in and we would go. And believe it or not, they closed it down because not enough women were going to prison. So they opened up the prison in Chowchilla, the women's prison. There used to be two women, but now there's only one, and the other one converted into men. That same year, God opened the door for me to go to Old Folsom. We had a man that did two life sentences. His name is Brother Noe Valdivia. He was the apostolic pastor in Folsom. And he had two life sentences, but he was a man that believed in a living God, baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost. They took one life away, and he had another life while he was in prison. And he said, "If they took one, why can't they take another one? I serve a good God." So he was there. Me and Brother Noe were there, and Brother Angel and Brother Fabian, and someone would go every Saturday. It almost felt like I was going every Saturday. My wife could probably be a witness, because, you know, I was so hungry to do something for God. I was so hungry just to do something for him. And we would go, and one day, Brother Noe, his wife, excuse me, before his wife gave him the divorce paper, that same week he got denied. A 2-year denial. And I asked him the question, "What are you going to do now? What are you going to do now? I know you just got denied. I know your wife just gave you divorce papers. What are you going to do?" You know what he said? Full of the Holy Ghost. He said, "When I get out, I'm going to find me a new Cadillac." Brother Noe is living in Oakland right now, today, with a wife, two children, amen, ages 5 and 3. God has given him a new life. God has given him a new wife, all because he is sold out to Jesus. He's given his life to Jesus. I seen this woman at Landmark this year. She walked up to me and she said, "You recognize me?" And I just smiled, huh? Because I don't know. You just smile when you don't know. She said, "I was a guard at Mule Creek." She said, "I was a guard there. And I would always hear on the radio, and I would always see on the paper, Apostolic Services. And one day when you were coming in, I asked you the question, are they really real? Are they really apostolic? Are they really baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost?" I said, "They are really real, filled with the Holy Ghost, baptized in Jesus' name. They are real." Guess what? Now she's a member of CLC, serving the Lord, loving Jesus. Usually, amen, I got my Bible today. But usually, you know, you got your iPad. You know, you're walking all fancy. You're walking church all fancy. Sometimes I went to the prison one time. And when I went to the prison, I forgot my Bible. And, you know, I just say, I'll walk in and I'll grab one from the bench. And I'll just go up there and I'll start preaching. And when I walked in, I showed them my ID, and I gave them my California ID. They gave me my state ID. I put it in my pocket, and as we was walking away, the guard said, "You forgot something." And then I said, "What did I forget?" And I thought I forgot my keys or something there. He said, "You forgot your Bible. Where's your Bible?" And I said, "You know what, sir? You're right. I did forget my Bible." Let me tell you something. When you're apostolic, this is all we have. This is all we have. We have the Word. We have His Word. We have His Word. I go every, and I'm kind of here to get someone excited, because there is opportunity at the county jail for men or women that want to go and give this apostolic message. We go every Sunday from 10 to 11. Amen. It's 1 hour. Ain't going to hurt nobody. But to share the gospel, to share the Word of God, to share the living Word with somebody. This is alive. This is well. I want to, this is my email. Amen. It's called Apostolic Prison Ministry. That's the website. Amen. You get a chance, pray for us. Don't get a chance. Just pray for us. Hallelujah. Just pray. Amen. Don't think about it. But when you do think about it, pray. Amen. But that's Apostolic Prison Ministry. I'm sorry. I used to have two of these. This one looks like it's on its last leg, but it's here. But it says, think souls. Think souls. They could be your kids, your grandkids, your bad kids, but they're your kids and they're your souls. Those are yours, souls. I want to just share with you some ministries. Amen. Amen, about souls. And what if I had the title this today, it would be Revival versus Evangelism. Revival versus Evangelism, because some people think, man, if we're having people getting baptized and people getting the Holy Ghost, we're in revival. Friend of mine, that is not revival, that is evangelism. Revival is something that's dead that needs to come back to life. God is looking for soul winners. And let me tell you, if winning souls don't get you excited, you probably need revival. Because it's nothing like soul winning. There's nothing like seeing someone come to the house of God that's never been. We have an outreach ministry. Amen. We have an outreach ministry that goes down to the women's shelter. Amen. And this is the past 2-3 weeks. This isn't, amen, 10 years ago, but this is the past 2-3 weeks. You see, a lot of churches will go down there and give them blankets and give them food and tell them about Jesus and go home and feel real good about themselves, about what they did. But how many know it's much more than that? You can feed someone, but have you told them about Jesus? You can tell them about that Jesus loved them, but have you showed them that Jesus loves them? We have a team that not only goes down there and feeds them, but gets to know them as a friend, gets to know them as people, gets their phone numbers, begins texting them, begins calling them. We had a lady Super Bowl Sunday. She was going to get baptized, but she ended up in the hospital. And some people would have said, oh, well, then I guess she didn't want to get baptized. No, my friend, that sometimes that's how the enemy wants to make us think. But when she was in the hospital, the same sisters that would text her and call her and became her friend went into the hospital and began to pray for her and say, hey, God can heal you. God can touch your body. God can take you out of this bed. February 10th, the very next Sunday, the Sunday that just passed, the same lady that was in the hospital was baptized in Jesus' name. Yes, we want to be soul winners, but there has to be results. We got to do it with purpose. There has to be a reason. Huh? Come on, somebody. Usually at the prison, I have guards walk me out. I might have a pastor walk me out to here. Tell him I'm done. But having outreach. So they invite them to church. I bought a bus. You see, because either you're going to get convicted to do something, or I'm just confirming of what you're already doing. And if you're being convicted, you probably need revival. But if I'm confirming to a soul winner that knows what I'm talking about, that will do whatever they have to do to tell someone about Jesus. Two years ago, I was listening to, amen, God bless Holy Ghost Radio, but I was listening to Holy Ghost Radio. There really is a station called that, if you didn't know. Amen, it's an app. It has preachings on there. But they go live stream, and there was a man preaching live stream. I remember it was in 2017 because I had just bought a car, 2017 car. And he said, if you have a car of 2017 and you don't have a bus, your priorities are in the wrong place. Devil, you are a liar. But I got convicted. I got convicted because I did have a 2017. You see, at one time we did have a bus that was blessed to us and they gave it to us and we seen children come to Sunday school and then, amen, amen, the buses wear out. Amen, it's a material thing, they wear out. But because I had the car and I heard the preaching and I got convicted, I went out and I bought another bus. Now, coming from a pastor's home, And I probably say this too much, amen, amen, but that's why I'm here, to say it over here. But too many people, and it probably doesn't happen here, Pastor, but too many members have great ideas on how to win souls, and they want to go tell the pastor, they want to go tell the ministers so that they can do it. Did you know God put that in your heart so you can do it? God doesn't put stuff in our hearts so we can tell the pastor to do it, but God wants us to do it. God wants us. He wants to use us. So we got the bus, and we got kids coming in, amen. And now you know it's not as full as we wanted, but hey, we'll take whoever, and they come and they get on the bus, and we bring them to church, and then, amen. The shelter ministry is just flourishing from the baptisms, and when we go over there Friday nights, we pick them up, we're bringing them to church, and we were there. Hear me, we were there at the shelter. And people were getting on the bus, and this bus we had, it only has 12 seats, and we had them all full. People wanted to get on the bus, but they couldn't because it was full. I got convicted. Because I don't want to be the one to turn someone away from the gospel. I don't want to be the one. Someone wants a ride to church, ask for a ride to church. Who am I not to give them a ride if God has blessed me with transportation? If God has blessed me with a job? If God has blessed me with children that love the Lord? If God has blessed me with grandchildren that are worshipers unto God? Who am I to turn people away? I don't know if she knows, but don't tell her. About a second bus. Did you know that? Oh. About a second bus. Because I got convicted. Huh? Sitting at the church right now, it needs work, but guess what? This one has 12 seats, that one has 22. All the time, the enemy will have us think, oh, it's too much money, it's too much expenses, and, you know, and all this. Let me tell you something. I have yet to miss a meal. If it's his will, it's his bill. He provides a need. He makes a way. He puts people. Think souls, my friends. Think souls. That's all it's about. Huh? Sunday school. Yeah, I know y'all got Wednesday. We used to call it Wow Wednesday. Amen. But Wednesday school, Tuesday school, Sunday school. And those are ministries. Amen. And those are awesome ministries. But I'm here to ask, what about the children that haven't came in a while? What about the ones that used to come? Who's reaching out to them? You see, the teacher's busy teaching. But there might be someone here that says, I can text someone. I can call someone. I can reach out. Because this is what it's about. Bus ministry. I had a little girl get on the bus. 11 years old, and she asked me the question, how old do you have to be baptized in Jesus' name? She never would have had that question in her mind if she never would have walked in an apostolic church from a bus picking her up and bringing her. Getting on this ragged old bus saying, this is the most beautifulest thing I've seen. I said, where? hospital ministry. You know, that's a prison in itself. No one wants to be in prison and no one wants to be in the hospital. That's a prison in itself. I've been in hospitals where I'm walking to go pray for someone and someone else is pulling me this way. Can you come pray over here? Because anytime there is a need and then there is prayer, that is the perfect remedy for a miracle. Because God would only make a miracle when there's a need. Doesn't take money to be in the hospital ministry. It takes someone with a willing heart. I go, hey man, I told him we're going to go again this year, but a couple years back, we went down to the county hospital, took a couple cases of water, started handing out water. Would you like prayer? Would you like prayer? Begin to pray for people. Begin to tell them about Jesus. Did it at Dameron, did it at St. Joe's. Doesn't take much. It takes someone with conviction. It takes someone. Know this. Whatever you pray for somebody, God in time will bless you with it. If I pray for healing on somebody, I know my healing's on the way. Maybe I don't need it right now, but God, know my voice, know my faith, know my belief in you that you can heal, because I know one day I'm going to need healing. I know one day I'm going to need you, and I want you to know me, Lord. Know me as your servant. Know me as your prisoner. Know me as your worshiper unto you. Greeting ministry. Oh Lord. I heard someone say the other day, he said, souls are coming. And if you don't want souls to take your seat, go find another church, because we need your seat anyway. Greeting ministry. We think it's just for the, amen, the brothers and the sisters that run around and do all the ushering and do all that. Let me tell you, where you're sitting, I've anointed you a greeter. That could be your ministry. I pray a conviction right now upon everyone by the sound of my voice that anytime they're in the house of God, if there's someone sitting by them, to the left, to the right, to the front of them, to the back of them, and they don't know their name, God convict their hearts to introduce themselves, because they might be the only you that they'll ever meet. They might be the last time they ever come to church. Give us the opportunity, Lord, to be the friendliest. Lord God, to be the most nicest, gentlest person. Huh? Can't leave it for no one else. Follow up. You know what the follow up ministry is? And they're probably not here, but sometimes the musicians, the praise team, the ministers, the ushers, they see someone come into church, then they see him a second time. That's your opportunity for a follow-up ministry. That's what follow-up ministry. If God has quickened your spirit, he's been here before, she's been here before, what's stopping you from going up to them and saying, hey, say, I'm glad you came back. Let's go get something to eat. Let's do something. Just me and you. Tell me about your name. Tell me who you are. Think souls. Someone say, think souls. nursing home ministry. Every first and third Saturday from 10 to 11, I go to a nursing home on Golden Living, on Rosemary. It's Rosemary and Pershing. And I go there, and I see people bound in wheelchairs. Some of them can't even think when you ask them their name. The thought can't go from here to here. But to tell them about Jesus, to tell them about a healer, to tell them about a way maker. I just share the gospel. Just share the gospel. That's all I want to do. Share the gospel. God, the Bible says to every creature, to every creature. You know, and I'm there, and one day I thought about it. I was there, and you always think, well, are they really, is it really worth it? Are they really grasping it? Are they really understanding? And when I left, my dad was alive then. But I called my dad, and he was in his right mind. My mom is healthy. Mom and dad have health. They're not bound by wheelchairs or sicknesses. But that's because they had God all their lives. God has blessed them. God has kept them. But there are souls that just need to hear. Just need words of encouragement. They get anything, they get my big ugly smile. Friendship groups. Cell groups, sharing the word, sharing the gospel. You can have a musician. Friendship groups. And there's a big difference between a friendship group and a Bible study. You see, if a friendship group, you're introducing them to the concept of Jesus Christ. You're getting them to accept Jesus Christ. You can have a friendship group at Starbucks. You can have a friendship group anywhere. Meet them. Talk to them. But a Bible study, we're getting into the Word. There's hungry people that want to know. It's very simple how we and we give it. I gave lesson aid from Search for Truth. Amen. We had four youth get baptized, and I gave lesson aid to them from Search for Truth. It's awesome. But let me tell you something. Amen. Old Testament, the need of salvation. The New Testament, how to be saved, Jesus Christ. And the consequences of not being saved, where we're living at today. You don't have to be a scholar, you just have to be convicted. You just have to be convicted. Because I know if I reach out to the community, God's going to send someone to reach out to my family. If I reach out to my neighbor, God's going to reach out and use someone to reach out for my friends. You see, I'm not here to save the world, but to save my world. People that are connected to me, my neighbors, my friends, my co-workers, my schoolmates. Huh? You're my enemies, hallelujah. people that are connected. Let us stand. Reentry ministry. 90% of the men and women that are living in prison, we eventually come out one day. 90%. And they got to go somewhere. It's a place of refuge. This is a place of refuge. A place where they can come. I'm going to ask you one more time to lift your hands with me. You see, as your hands are lifted, that's a sign of surrenderance. It's a sign that your heart is open, your mind is open. It's a sign that Jesus is your answer. And because he is your answer, you can share him. Because he's the answer of the world today. Father, I ask you right now, every man, woman, boy, and girl that has their hands lifted right now, we commit our lives to you to think souls, to think about our neighbors, our friends, our co-workers, our children, our grandchildren, their souls, God. People at the nursing home, people in prison, people at the hospital, people on the street, people I see every day, Lord, in my life. You've given me this job that I may tell someone about you. You've given me friends that don't know you yet so I can tell them about you, Lord. I ask you right now, God, give us a hunger. Give us a passion for people. Let us think, Lord. Let us think, Lord. Let us ponder on souls. God Almighty, it's not about finances. The money is yours. It's not about time. The time is yours. The opportunity you've given us, Lord, to be this light, God. I thank you, Lord. I thank you right now. Blessings upon this household of faith, God. Be upon them in Jesus' name. Everyone clap your hands.
For just a moment, if you can just begin to intercede for just a second. Begin to intercede for just a second here and just begin to intercede for our city. For the city of Stockton, the San Joaquin Valley. Begin to envision. You need to close your eyes for this one. Begin to close your eyes and envision God already touching those all around you. God has given you some of your burdens right now. For a friend, a family member, a co-worker, for a relative, for an associate, someone sitting next to you. God is beginning to give you them right now in your mind. And you need to focus on that right now. Some of you need just to enter into speaking in tongues and let the Holy Ghost begin to just well up on the inside of you and let there be a burden that's set upon your soul for that individual. The Holy Ghost will make intercession for you with groanings that cannot be uttered by the natural tongue. In the name of Jesus, you need to see that man. You need to see that woman. You need to see that group of kids that hang out on your corners, that stand in the streets, that you see every day when you go to work. You need to see that coworker that sits alone all by themselves in a cubicle. You need to intercede for them right now. There's something happening in the Holy Ghost. There's an anointing that's been unleashed by the man of God in this place tonight. It's called conviction. Let the conviction of the Spirit, let the nudging of the Holy Ghost begin to well up on the inside of you. Begin to heed the call to go to everywhere, in every place, into the highways and into the byways and into the hedges, and compel them to come and tell them about the name of Jesus Christ. Begin to compel them to come on in. There's still room at the Master's table. There's still room at the Master's table. It has their name on it. You've got to see it. You've got to feel it. You've got to know it. You've got to believe it. In the name of Jesus, Roshi Tararamaya, begin to tear down the walls that stand between them and God. You're the one. You're the intercessor. The Lord has looked, and he looked for an intercessor. At one time, he couldn't find one. And there was one man that stood up and said, Lord, send me. I'll go. Is there somebody in this place that's saying, the Lord is birthing something in my spirit. The Lord is birthing a soul in my spirit, and I'm going to step out and I'm going to do exactly what God wants me to do. I'm going to go to them and preach the gospel to every creature, whomever will listen, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we call upon you right now. We call upon you right now. We call upon you right now. Lord, let the word preached, taught, testimony given, let it resonate inside of our soul. Lord Jesus, accomplish that which no man can do, but the Holy Ghost can do. Lord, let spirit begin to link up with spirit tonight, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah! Lord, we praise your name. God, we give you glory in this place. Go ahead and enter in just for a minute and begin to praise the name of Jesus for what he's going to do and for what he is doing, for the anointing of God. We lift up your name, God. We praise your name, Lord. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand for Minister Creo, what he gave here tonight. If any of you are interested in being involved, especially with the prison jail ministry, please see Brother Creo afterwards. He has applications that he can give you and start getting you started on backgrounds and things of that nature and getting you started. God wants to do something everywhere. Everywhere. Can you say everywhere? Here's the thing that I really, really, I'm glad you spoke and what you said, but the thing that really resonated is allowing God to convict you. Conviction is the gentle nudge of the Holy Ghost. Okay? That's when you know that you're being led of God. Not because he hit you over the head. To be led of the Spirit is to obey the initial promptings of the Holy Ghost. That he just can touch you, whisper to you, still small voice. And you say, man, that bothers me. Whatever's bothering you about this city, and God is wanting you, first of all, to start praying about it, and then start listening, how can I do something about it? And then be willing to do something. Not just pass it along to someone else, like you said tonight. Not just tell me or tell someone else and say, hey, that'd be a good thing to do. No, that's God saying, that's what you're going to do. And, you know, whenever you pay the price for something like that, that means there's going to be a weight. And I just want to say that. This is a disclaimer. Or it's a warning. Then you'll have to keep up your prayer life because you will come under severe attack in all kinds of different areas. But if God told you that, you have to be able to endure the storms, pass through the storms, come out on the other side, and actually see everything that God is going to do. Because there's a demon on the other side that's waiting there to be delivered. But you have to be trained. So once you say yes, and we have pastors in here and different ones that have ministered and stuff like that, that once you accept that call, whatever's going along with that will come. But greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. So what you do
Because you don't get high-minded, you don't get arrogant, you don't get, here I am doing all this. You get to the place where you say, Lord, it's here. I'm here every day. I'm here. I'm talking to you, Lord. Fortify me, examine me, collect all my thoughts, collect me up. Lord, begin to examine me, Lord, and correct me. Do whatever you need to do to get me ready for the day. Daily bread, but also, Lord God, things what I need for the future. Begin to infuse my mind. Let me cast down imaginations, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Jesus Christ. Lord, put the armor on me. Do whatever you need to do. I just need it for today. I don't need it tomorrow. I need it right now in the name of Jesus. You need it right now, God. You need now faith. You need whatever you need for that day, because what he told you way back when has not changed. He's not going to change his mind. He wants to know, are you willing? Because a lot of people, they're willing, but once they start getting hit in the back, sucker punched and all that kind of stuff, they're like, I'm out. But then there's those, okay, many of you are falling in that category, that take the punch, get hit, get stabbed, get cut, get opened up. You go in and say, well, just give me an open heart surgery. Go on and give me a new limb. Prosthesis if I need it, whatever I need to accomplish your will. And then you just go limping back in there. Paul said it just like this, and I'm closing because we're right at that time. But Paul said it like this: I bear the marks of Christ in my body. He just said, I bear the marks of Christ. You're going to get some marks. He said, I was shipwrecked. He said, I was beaten with rods. I was stoned. I was left for dead. He said, I was denied my countrymen. I was lied on. All this stuff. And he said, you know what? And I'm not even offended. I'm not even offended. I burn not. It's all for the glory of God. Who wants that? Come on, let's praise him. Hallelujah. You need to get happy about that. That's ministry. That's God. That's power. You're going to see the dead raised. You're going to see the blind see. You're going to see those that are deaf begin to hear. You're going to begin to see people and see great things happen in this city because you're willing to do whatever God wants you to do. Oh, yeah, rejoice, not because of the glory, but rejoice because your names are written in heaven and you're able to do whatever God told you to do. Hallelujah! Jesus, we praise you. We honor you. Let me pray over you. And again, see Brother Creo, Minister Creo, and greet Sister Creo before they leave. And let me pray over you right now before you go get your kids and get them ready for school tomorrow. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray that the word that was taught, preached, the testimony that was given, Lord, the concepts and, Lord, the burden that was shed out here, Lord, that we would not just trample on it, nor would we just ignore it. But God, we will grab all onto it, and we will do exactly what you said for us to do. Make disciples of all men, Lord God. Teach them, baptize them, and get them ready for the kingdom of God. I pray that in the name of Jesus, that you'll bless the Creo family, Lord, and everything that they do, and everywhere that they go, and God, everything that you're doing through them. I pray, God, that ministry in this city, Lord God, would go over the top, especially in these last days, in the name of Jesus, that, Lord, men and women that we come in contact with, rub shoulders with, and that we're able to influence, that, God, we will live the life in front of them, and we would begin to encourage them and give them a second chance, third chance, fourth chance, a million chances, whatever it is, and whatever they need to get up, help us to compel them to come in. I pray over this congregation, Lord God, and those that would watch, and those that, Lord, are listening, in the name of Jesus, that we would bleed over into every life that we come in contact with, and that, Lord, they would embrace the gospel of Jesus Christ, they would become followers of Jesus Christ, that they would repent of their sins and turn from this world, and, Lord, they would go into the waters of baptism and take on the name of Jesus Christ, and that God, that you would fill them, baptize them, immerse them with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, with the initial sign of speaking with other tongues. Let it be so, and God, let that be our mantra. Let that be the gospel we preach and what we teach, and let us just begin to rejoice as we see men and women entering into the kingdom, God, and don't let us get weary in well-doing, for in due season, we're going to reap as long as we don't faint. Let us not faint in this, Lord, but give us the strength for the day in Jesus' name. Can you say in Jesus' name? Can you say in Jesus' name?
Come on, and let's put our hands together for the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you. If I can have a couple of men just help Creoles get this all locked up and put it in their car. But also, if you need to see him about an application, make sure you see him before they leave.